Thank you so much for coming. Can you believe it? This is the 16th annual Martin Luther King Jr. Community Breakfast. Always free. And it's our annual opportunity to celebrate the life and contributions of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Each year we use this time to focus on a quote from his most famous speech, I Have a Dream. And that quote goes that one day my four little children will live in a country where they are judged not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. It is a tradition at BCC to celebrate Dr. King's values on today, but not just every day. Every day. Let's get that right. To set aside and remember his legacy. And it's appropriate for us to do so because Dr. King held dear, and what he held dear is what we hold dear at Bristol Community College. Social justice, equality, and opportunity for all. These are our standards and our goals. As we begin, please welcome the Reverend Daryl Malden, pastor of Bethel AME Church at Fall River, to provide our invocation. Reverend Daryl Malden.
Thank you, President Sprager. If we could just calm ourselves for just a minute, if we could just have a minute just of meditation before we invoke the Spirit of God. I want to invite you after this breakfast to my church, Bethel AME Church, at 146 Hanover Street for worship services. It should start at about 11 o'clock, right after the breakfast. I think it's essential during this time in our lives where there's so much hate and so much violence and terror for us of people to get together, and maybe we can have a worship service together. So please join me at my church at 11 o'clock, right after the breakfast, 146 Hanover Street, right here in Fall River. If we could just, to the people to the right, if we could just calm ourselves for a second so we can have an invocation. And just a moment of meditation, because we're going through a lot. There's a lot happening in the world. So if you please, let's bow our heads. I'm going to pray in the name of Jesus Christ, but please pray in the name of your God. God, in this time of hate and violence and terror, we have gathered together in peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. And so on this day, we gather in the memory of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, and because it is his holiday, and recognize his contribution. But there were others who contributed as well to the civil rights movement, a movement of equality and justice and love. And so we come to celebrate today. But God, even as we live our day-to-day lives, it seems like one day runs into another, and one week runs into another week, and one month into another month, and a year into another year. We just get sort of caught up, and things don't seem as important, and it's just every day seems the same. But God, let's shake things up this year. Let's give us the inspiration to love more and to seek more peace, and to seek a more brotherhood and sisterhood. Let's shake things up that we're not in the same old routine of jealousy and spite, but we're working together for a better society. And Fall River has already started to shake things up, and we pray for the leadership in Fall River. We pray for the leadership in Massachusetts, and even on this campus, God, that we as people of God will come together to live better lives, but only by your strength. So bless these people today. Have your spirit dwell among us, that we may have a beautiful program in the honor of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. But even more than that, once we leave this program and once we leave the church service, that we may take peace into our community, that we may take love into our community, and that we may take justice into our community. In your name we pray. Somebody say amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Mauldin. I remind you that after this, as always, every year, after this ceremony, we have a ceremony at the Bethel AME Church, 146 Hanover Street, and Reverend Mauldin will be conducting that, another part of the tradition of Martin Luther King Day. This breakfast brings together the community to stage a grand celebration, and we've invited elected officials to join the breakfast. Several are here, and you will meet them after the breakfast. But while our two U.S. senators could not attend, they send you some brief greetings that we will share with you now.
Good morning. I would much rather be with you in person today at Bristol Community College for the 16th annual Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Community Breakfast. But I'm afraid we're going to have to do this one by video. So let me just start by thanking President Sebrega for inviting me to join you this morning. On Martin Luther King Jr. Day, we celebrate the powerful legacy of Dr. King, and we recommit ourselves to continuing his work to end racial injustice and to help America move one step closer to her founding promise of equality for all. Last March, I visited with an elderly man at the First Baptist Church in Montgomery, Alabama. We were having coffee and donuts in the church basement before the service started. And he told me that more than 50 years earlier, in May of 1961, he had spent 11 hours in that same basement along with hundreds of people while a mob outside threatened to burn down the church because it was a sanctuary for civil rights workers. Dr. King was there. He called Attorney General Bobby Kennedy, desperately asking for help. The Attorney General promised to send the army, but the closest military base was several hours away. So the members of the church and the civil rights workers waited in this sweltering basement, crowded together, listening to the mob outside, and hoping the U.S. Army would arrive in time. After the church service, I asked Congressman John Lewis about that night. He had been right there in the church back in 1961 while the mob gathered outside. He'd been in the room during the calls to the Attorney General. And I asked him if he had been afraid that the Army just wouldn't make it in time. And he said he was never, ever afraid. You come to that point where you lose all sense of fear. And then he said something I will never forget. He said his parents didn't want him to get involved in civil rights. They didn't want him to cause trouble, but he had done it anyway. He told me, sometimes it is important to cause necessary trouble. The first civil rights battles were hard fought, and in the past half century, our country has made real progress. But we can't ignore reality. There are those who want to reverse those gains, those who want to take away votes, those who want to make it harder to get an education, those who believe that justice and dignity are reserved only for some people. As we honor Dr. King today, we are reminded that we have much work to do to keep the progress that we have made and to move this country forward. We know where we are headed, and we know what we have to do to continue the fight for full equality. It comes to us to continue this fight, to make, as John Lewis says, the necessary trouble until we can truly say that in America, every citizen enjoys the conditions of freedom. So, thank you, and happy Martin Luther King Jr. Day.
I'm so sorry that I can't join you today to celebrate the tremendous life and the spirit of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., one of the greatest Americans to have ever enlightened and empowered our world. Thank you, President Jack Sprague, for bringing everyone together for today's event. Thank you for your leadership. Thank you for your dedication. At Bristol Community College, we know that in the middle of your name is the word community, but excellence is what everyone knows you for in the Fall River community and throughout the Commonwealth. Congratulations to Adair Lopes, this year's distinguished African-American alumnus. I also want to congratulate today's featured keynote speakers, Brothers Keeper. You are healing, inspiring, and energizing through the spoken word. We hear you, and we are grateful for your sharing of your art. This past year was a challenging one in our society, and we missed Dr. King a little bit more. In cities and on campuses across America, we missed his guidance and his grace. Because in places like Baltimore, Chicago, Boston, and throughout the country, men, women, students, and young people of every race took to the streets to demand justice. They stood up, they marched, they chanted, they cried, and they pleaded for justice. They are following the lessons of Dr. Martin Luther King, combating violence with nonviolence, opposing brutality with spirituality. They represent the reason why our country has progressed and persevered for centuries, because at the core of our nation and in the hearts of Americans is the unending pursuit of equal justice. Dr. King taught us that equal justice is the surest and the safest path. Hello, Bristol community, and persevered for centuries, because at the core of our nation and in the hearts of Americans is the unending pursuit of equal justice. Dr. King taught us that equal justice is the surest and the safest path towards the peace we all seek for our families, for our communities, and for our country. Equal justice comes from a quality education and the opportunity to go to college that doesn't result in mountains of debt. You can maximize your God-given abilities without having to have a debt you carry for the rest of your life. Equal justice comes from good jobs with a fair wage and the ability to climb the ladder of success. And equal justice comes from safe and secure communities, free of the gun violence and the addiction that is devastating our communities. We are all students of the great Dr. King. And as individuals of good conscience, we must now rise up and make sure that we have a country which is fair, a country which is balanced, and a country where everyone can maximize their God-given abilities. And so, to the students of Bristol Community College here today, this is your charge to help shape the course of history consistent with the time-honored values that have animated civilization for generations and that were epitomized by the life of Dr. Martin Luther King. As a senator from Massachusetts, I will continue to make Bristol Community College and educational institutions like it across Massachusetts and across our country my top priority. Ensuring that you all have the resources you need is the greatest investment that we can make in the future of our country. Young people are only 25% of our population, but they're 100% of our future. We must invest in you. So today, I thank you for everything you do to continue the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King, and may God bless his soul and his works and all of the good works which you are all going to do in his name. Thank you.
I know some of you are not quite finished yet, but I think we're going to move forward and welcome our musical group to get us started to resume the program. Feel free to go back up. There are plenty of food up there. But we need to move forward if we can. And we have a musical group called Music One who will perform for us. Music One is an innovative enrichment program designed to support and educate youth by cultivating their talents in original, positive, musical, and multimedia projects while providing mentoring, leadership development, and empowerment. We are delighted that they could join us today. So please, if we could keep it a little quiet, and let's welcome, if you would, Music One. Music One.
How's everybody doing? I can't hear you. How's everybody doing? I still can't hear you. How's everybody doing? Okay, all right. That's a good start. All right. Hi, my name is Terrell Osborne, and I am the proud director of this youth program entitled Music One. And I bring you greetings from Only Street Baptist Church. I bring you greetings from 95.5 WBIU In the Spirit, Southern New England's number one gospel program. And it's all about the young people. It's all about youth, right? Like we said in the video, the youth are 25%, but they're 100% of our future. And in Music One, we pride ourselves on doing all original music, music with no swearing, no cussing, no talking about people. You know what I mean? It's Music One of power, of positivity. And I want you to give these young people a big round of applause, Miss Priscilla Montero. Come on, you can do better than that. You just had a Patriots game, you do a lot better than that, right? Miss Priscilla Montero and Miss Deanna Green right here. Come on, make some noise. Don't be shy, all right? So I'm gonna get out the way. I'm gonna let them talk to you for a minute while I get to the back over there, all right?
Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome. Can we hear some noise? Woo, yeah, no. All right, well, we're gonna do a few songs for you guys, and we do want you guys to be a little bit hyped up for this song. So when you catch on to the chorus, don't feel scared to sing along, because it's really easy. So here we go. Whenever Terrell's ready. You guys can clap along with us.
Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Don't you know it'd be better if we put our hands up together?
Find a way, our dream into peace. But reality keeps the world from what it can be. I wish that the world can see that we can be more than what meets the eye. You and I, changing the world before the lightning strikes. The lightning strikes.
Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Don't you know it'd be better if we put our hands up together?
There is light in every darkness. Keep the time and it will show. Show the path to new beginnings and lead us closer as we grow. We are all in one. We can work together now. Change just who we are. Reaching for the stars.
Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Don't you know it'd be better if we put our hands up together?
Look through the mirror, look back at the world. What do you see? People fighting for more money, more power. But ultimately, we all end up in the same place. Fighting for the same things.
Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Don't you know it'd be better if we put our hands up together?
And if you don't believe in changes, it's not just to find the faith. It's much simpler than that. It's an energy that's transferred when you practice what you're preaching, and the rest forms on its own. Hey,
together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world.
Don't you know it'd be better if we put our hands up together?
All right, now everybody has to start singing along. Come on, guys, put your hands up. Woo! Ready?
Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Don't you know it'd be better if we put our hands up together? Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. Together we can better the world. We can better the world. Don't you know it'd be better if we put our hands up together?
Thank you. Music won, ladies and gentlemen. Let's hear it for them. You know, our annual Martin Luther King Jr. Breakfast is a collaboration of the college and members of the community who joined together to recognize the groundbreaking work and the wonderful, inspirational life of Dr. King on the holiday held in his honor. This is not a day off, but a day on, to remember Dr. King's dreams and goals, to continue moving toward them. I can recall at the time when Dr. King was in his Birmingham jail, and he was hearing from black ministers, "Hey, Martin, why are you doing this? You're bringing a bad reputation to us. You're tarnishing us all. Why are you there?" And he said simply, "I'm there because that's where injustice is." And he was in the Birmingham jail and living up to his values. A recent book by a noted historian, Cornel West, talks about the radicalism of Dr. King. But if you think a moment, radicalism means a promotion of change. And he is what we would call a change agent. As he brought together in juxtaposition with nonviolence, he brought his radical views, if you will, civil rights, not only, and the Vietnam War. He moved from simply black issues to issues for all who are poor, and to raise up the standards in the country. And for that, he made the supreme sacrifice, unfortunately. But his inspiration, his life is an inspiration to us. And that's why we continue every year to have this community breakfast, to do what we can at Bristol Community College to keep alive his dream, to keep alive the wonderful principles that he stood for. So we're very happy to do this at Bristol Community College, and we're very happy to have the community support as we do every year. So thank you very much for coming. Now, we've heard from the two U.S. senators from Massachusetts. Now I'm pleased to introduce the video greetings from two of our congressmen, and Congressman Keating and Congressman Kennedy.
Good morning. I'm Congressman Bill Keating, and I want to thank Bristol Community College for inviting me to participate again in their annual breakfast to honor the life of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I also want to congratulate Adair Lopes, the 2016 Distinguished African-American Alumnus of the Year. What a great honor it is to be recognized not only in the memory of Dr. King's legacy, but also as a member of a notable group of alumni who've received this award previously. At its heart, Dr. King's message, his dream, is one of hope, of positivity, of inclusion, of equality, and of fairness. It is 52 years since Dr. King made his historic speech, and while great strides have been made, our country is still plagued by many of the same struggles we saw then. The ability to vote, equal educational opportunity, economic and wage unfairness. Each year is another call to action and justice. In his letter from a Birmingham jail cell, Dr. Martin Luther King warns against applauding justice while sitting on the sidelines. He said, "Shallow understanding from people of goodwill is more frustrating than absolute misunderstanding from people of ill will. Lukewarm acceptance is much more bewildering than outright rejection. I know that many of us are united in our commitment to fulfilling his vision, and I'm inspired by the Adair Lopes among us, who put Dr. King's teachings into practice each and every day. Again, thank you, Bristol Community College, for your role in supporting our leaders of tomorrow and for the opportunity to join you this important morning.
Good morning, everybody. I'm disappointed to not be able to join you at today's breakfast, but I want to thank you for the kind invitation to participate and for giving me an opportunity to say a few words about the man you are celebrating this morning. Nearly half a century after his passing, Martin Luther King Jr.'s message of love, faith, and justice rings just as loudly today. At a time when a deep distrust plagued our nation, he held an equally deep conviction that compassion and understanding would overcome intolerance and ignorance. Given every reason to doubt the power of one person's voice, to question the potential for change in a stubborn society, he inspired millions to demand this country, our country, live up to its sacred promise of equality and justice for all Americans. It is not possible, he said, to be in favor of justice for some people and not be in favor of justice for all people. Justice cannot be divided. He knew that he could not bridge that divide alone, but he also knew that his words could never be ignored as long as his audience repeated them. He knew that the marches he led could never be forgotten because of those who stood behind him. And we know that his resounding message will be reaffirmed and remembered because communities like this one gather to celebrate his legacy and fight for the love, faith, and justice he believed in. So thank you for your moving tribute to one of our nation's proudest sons.
Well, thank you. It's wonderful to have two senators and our two congressional representatives be with us in spirit today. The event is organized by a committee, and I want to recognize their hard work. Our co-chairs, Sally Cameron and Tafa Awolaju, and other members who have given of themselves, Philomena Pont, Liz McCarthy, Cindy Poor Parasol, Bob Resendiz, Kevin Spurlett, Linda Viveros, and Dr. Ron Weisberger. Please recognize the great work that they have done. And I want to note also for you, we have a number of events that will be taking place throughout February for Black History Month, but also our Multicultural Committee throughout the spring. And you can find them all. There's some wonderful speakers and performances. They'll be available on our website, the BCC website. And I want to call particular attention, I hope you've seen this flyer. Dr. Ron Weisberger of our history department is offering a free course to go with your free breakfast on the readings of Martin Luther King Jr. And he'll be studying his words and his principles. And let's see if we can live up to that. So it's a free course for you. You can register for it right over here at the doorway or any other time for that matter online. And I want to thank Dr. Weisberger. He's here somewhere. If you would rise up and give us a wave. There he is, Ron Weisberger. Ron is also head of our Holocaust Center that we have here at the college. So please take advantage of this free course on Dr. King. And I want to acknowledge our musicians today. Such a wonderful atmosphere for the breakfast. Join with me to thank Louis Lima and Michael Crowley. I think they're eating now. They finally get a chance to eat, but I know you've enjoyed their music. And we are bringing together the community. We will have some community leaders that are here, and I know you'll want to meet or at least see that they're here and participating and supporting not only BCC, which they always support, but also the life and dreams of Dr. King. We're going to hear more from him a little bit later, but I first just want to introduce Jezel Correa, our mayor. Senator Mike Rodericks is here. Michael. Representative Carol Fiola. Representative Paul Schmidt. Representative Alan Silva. City Councilor Cliff Pond. City Councilor Steve Camara. There he is. School Committee, Dr. Edward Coaster. And School Committee, Paul Coogan. Paul. School Committee, Joseph Martins, always here every year. Thank you, Joseph. We have the District Attorney, Tom Quinn. Thomas Quinn. We have the acting interim Chancellor, Supreme Allied Commander of UMass Dartmouth, Jerry Kavanaugh. So great for him to be here. If you don't know Jerry, in a former iteration of his life, he was very instrumental in arranging for BCC to be stationed at 800 Purchase Street in New Bedford, and our New Bedford campus got a real kickstart from his work, and we're very grateful. Thank you, Jerry. We have the president of the Fall River Chamber of Commerce, Rob Million. Let's hear it for him. We also have trustees here today, Cynthia Rose, alumna of BCC as well. Her husband, Bruce Rose, is here, another alum of BCC. Jaziel Chase, a trustee, student trustee at BCC. There he is. Soon to be an alum. And I don't want, speaking of the radicalism of Dr. King and the keeping his hope alive, I don't want to ignore Marlene Pollack and Dan Gilbart, the great work of the Coalition for Social Justice. Thank you for all you do for social justice. Thank you. As I mentioned earlier, we have joined in our sponsorship of this breakfast, which helps us with a very important part of the event, our annual middle school poster contest. I hope you had the opportunity to see out in the lobby the posters in the lobby. And we have teachers and administrators from our various schools here to watch their students being honored. So, we have teachers here. Sandra Arnold is a teacher at Cuss Middle School, provides students from Whitney Academy, Pam Farrar, from and Michelle Reese, and Ray Brightman, let's hear it for her. Another educator, Jackie Arnold. Jackie Arnfeld is always here every year with her students. To honor the 50th anniversary of Dr. King's historic march on Washington in August of 63, the Board of Trustees at Bristol Community College created an essay competition inviting BCC students to write about the meaning of Dr. King's dreams and ideals. A faculty and staff committee headed by English professor Margaret Cox took the challenging task of choosing the winning entries. And the third place award, receiving a cash award of $100, is Ann Sylvia. Ann Sylvia of New Bedford. Ann won last year as well. Here she comes. To save time, I would like to invite the second place winner, Keith Dion of Fall River. And the first place winner, a cash award of $250, Anthony Perry of New Bedford. Anthony, congratulations.
get a picture, Kevin? Thank you. Congratulations. You gonna read it?
Yeah. She gonna read it?
He's reading it.
Yeah. And Anthony is going to read his winning essay to us, if you would, Anthony, sorry.
Good morning. The title of my essay is Timeless Visions. 212 years ago, Martin Luther King, standing beneath the symbolic shadow of the Lincoln Memorial, looked upon the National Mall and gave his speech of his vision for America. He called for change and unity, for all Americans to see each other as equals. The power of King's speech has gone down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of the United States. Although his speech was presented over half a century ago, its principles and ideals of peace and equality are still relevant today. King's recognition of the past can be applied to the present situation of racial discrimination. Through his American dream, he set a goal for America for the future. King references slavery and the racial injustices directed towards African Americans. Dr. King describes the injustices in the 1960s through the separation of the black and white communities, the right to vote, and the unspeakable horrors of police brutality. Through the dark past, King shines a light on the present and brings hope through his call for change. His hope that little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers sets a benchmark for civil equality. King's dream influences how to treat blacks and whites in all walks of life. While King's speech called for change in 1963, his message for unity can still be applied today. My dream is for racism to be eradicated, to stand as one people, one nation. As a nation, we have lost the sense of what is sacred. Not as what is sacred in a religious sense, but of the unalienable rights of humanity. For this to occur, we cannot discriminate against our fellow Americans and act inhumanely against each other. How can a divided, violent nation survive? How can anyone deny the racism behind the massacre of 9 African Americans in South Carolina? How can restaurants in several states refuse to serve policemen because of a single stereotype? Violence can only exist when there is some way to differentiate between one group or another. King himself declared the ultimate weakness of violence is that instead of diminishing evil, violence multiplies it. If we act out violently in such instances as Ferguson and Baltimore, how are we benefiting the nation? It begins with respect of others. It only takes one person, one example, such as Dr. King, for humanity to recognize, acknowledge, and embrace human dignity for all people. King's revolutionary ideals transformed American culture in the 1960s. His dream continues to manifest itself in American society. Yet King's message for unity and equality is still needed today. Violence is not the answer to our solutions. Peace and acceptance towards all is the only way America has the chance for all men and women, whether black, white, Hispanic, or Asian, to be equal. Thank you.
Anthony Perry, ladies and gentlemen. And now we'll hear from our cantor, Shoshana Brown from Temple Beth El, who will bring a brief reflection. Cantor Shoshana Brown.
Can you hear me?
was reflecting on how, on the words of Martin Luther King's most famous speech, I Have a Dream, parallel with some of the most famous words of the dreamer who dreamed up the idea of the Jews going back to their homeland and becoming a people with a land again, Theodor Herzl. He said, Im tirtzu, ein zo agada, if you will it, it is no dream. That was back around 1897. Both the Jews and African Americans have struggled throughout history with people judging them on something other than who they really are as people, on as looking at the color of their skin or at labels or other things that come between people. So really this is going to be more of a song, and I'm sorry that I didn't get time to get the words in the program, but it's an echo kind of song where I can sing a little piece of it and you can sing after me. It has a few Hebrew words, but mostly English words. So it's inspired by Theodor Herzl and by Dr. Martin Luther King. And it's to the tune of a well-known song, both in the black and the white Christian community, O Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. So I'll be expecting you to help me with this. Im tirtzu, im tirtzu, im tirtzu, im tirtzu, im tirtzu, ein zo agada, im tirtzu, tirtzu. Im tirtzu, im tirtzu. This one's together. Im tirtzu, ein zo agada. If we will it, if we will it, if we believe it, if we believe it, if we demand it, if we demand it, it is no dream, it is no dream. If we will it, if we demand, believe it, if we demand it, it is no dream. Oh Lord, prepare us. Oh Lord, prepare us to be a true community, to be a true community with opportunity, justice and liberty, justice, liberty. Grant us the vision, grant us the vision to bring to fruition, to bring to fruition a shining nation. Shining nation for all to see, for all to see. Im tirtzu, im tirtzu, im tirtzu, im tirtzu, ein zo agada. If we will it, if we believe it, if we demand it, it is no dream.
Donna Brown, everybody. Please join with me now to welcome another one of our community partners, the mayor of our great city of Fall River, the Honorable Jaisal Correa II.
who will bring greetings from the city and then announce the winners of the poster contest.
Thank you. All right, get ready for my song. Here we go. I'm going to sing together. No, I cannot sing at all. I was attempting it, but wow, that was incredible. That was really something. Please give all the singers and the essay winner another round of applause. That was incredible. Really moving. And some excellent words and phrases. And I like to pick out words and phrases and different things. And that's what I'm going to share today with you before we get to the winners. So on behalf of the city, I want to thank you for being here at Bristol Community College this morning. I want to thank our honored guests, all of you was here in this room. I want to thank Jack Sprague. He didn't get a thanks today, so I want to give him a round of applause as well for all the work he does. Yes.
Thank you.
And what a great day to be here at BCC this morning, celebrating the life of a true American hero, a true inspiration, especially to myself, and just a great American. Today we celebrate the life of Martin Luther King Jr., a man who continues to inspire us every single day. One of the most important lessons we can learn from Martin Luther King Jr. is found in the grammatical details of his famous speech, I Have a Dream. Martin Luther King Jr. uses the personal pronoun we 35 times in his speech. And this is what really is incredible to me. The power of his message is so interesting. When I was growing up, and I'm still growing up, but when I was younger, that's the age thing, it's, we all are getting older. But when I was growing up, I remember the phrase, one person can make a difference. And that's so true about Martin Luther King Jr. But what's interesting about his message is that that one person doesn't do it alone. He does it with many people. He does it together. So his inspirational speech, I Have a Dream, although it's the I, he says we 35 times, because together we can accomplish great things. It doesn't matter your race, it doesn't matter your religion, it doesn't matter where you are, the socioeconomic status that you have. Together is his message, one of being together. And I think that transcends through almost all different parts of our lives. You don't learn by yourself, you learn from people. You learn from the great teachers at Bristol Community College. You learn through your friends, your family, and you become a better person. And Martin Luther King Jr.'s message is to be the best that you can be, but to work with your community and become a better community as one. So with that being said, I want to thank BCC for having me this morning. I want to thank you for listening to my comments. And I'm excited about the future of not just Fall River, but of humanity. One that although we have many challenges, together we will fight them, we will face these challenges, and we'll make a better community. So thank you this morning.
Thank you. Very nice.
Thank you. And now, okay, and we have a few winners of the Community Day Breakfast Poster Contest. So our first third place winner is awarded to Austin Braga from Whitney Academy. Austin, are you here? Okay. All right, while Austin's coming up, I'm gonna call up the next individual. Third place poster winner, Alexia Fonseca. Alexia, are you here? Okay, no? It's my middle name, by the way, Fonseca. Don't tell anyone, though.
That might be Austin Braga. Is that Austin?
Is that you, Austin?
This is Austin.
Come on up. Come on down. Third place poster winner, Adam Gillette, Talbot Middle School. No Adam? Okay.
Trinity.
Our next third place winner is Trinity Souza, also Talbot Middle School. Okay, third place winner, Francisco Diaz Rodriguez, Talbot Middle School. They must all be at home, you know, still drawing up posters and reading the I Have a Dream speech. That's okay. We'll get these over to them. We have the second place winner, Mackenzie Brophy, Cuss Middle School. All right. Come on down, Mackenzie. Second place, Mariana Dinas, Cuss Middle School. Okay. Second place, Andrew Frank, Whitney Academy. There we go. Big applause on that one. Nice. Give him a hand while he comes on up here. Second place, Jocelyn Pavon, Talbot Middle School. Second place, Laura Raposa, Talbot Middle School. Second place, Logan Tessier, Talbot Middle School. There you go, Logan. Tell you're excited. All right, and now we're on to our first place winners. First place winner, Alicia Gonzalez, Cuss Middle School. That's all the awards. Thank you, everyone. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We may have to make this a Martin Luther King brunch. I'm not sure the early morning fits with everything. Also, BCC doesn't close when it snows, unlike some public schools, I guess. Our Distinguished African American Alumnus Award is presented yearly by the BCC Alumni Association to recognize outstanding achievement. And here to introduce the award is Patricia Zukowski, RDH 73, for the BCC Alumni Association. Patricia Zukowski, ladies and gentlemen, BCC alum.
Good morning, all. The Bristol Community College Alumni Association members are delighted to be here to welcome the 2016 Distinguished African American Alumnus of the Year, Adair Lopes. Adair, You exemplify the doctrine of a giving, successful alum. Adia began his professional career, actually he began way back before, as a volunteer. And then his volunteerism started at South Coast Hospital Group, and then Adia continued as an employee at South Coast Hospital and assumed positions with increasing responsibility in the area of medical microbiology. In 2013, he was appointed clinical specialist in the microbiology laboratory at St. Luke's Hospital. Despite having a full professional schedule, Adia continued to volunteer for Bristol Community College. Most recently, in October of 2015, Adia began to chair the Clinical Laboratory Science Program of Bristol Community College. It is clear that Adia truly deserves to be honored by his alma mater. At this time, I would like to welcome Adia Lopes to accept his award.
Hello, everyone. For those that know me, I'm a man of few words. I don't want to be up here talking to you guys. It's been a great day. We're here to honor a wonderful man. I want to thank Professor Sabrega, Director Sabrega, the college and the community in general for putting such a great event together. My awards this morning goes to the current students and future students, since they are the future of our society, our community. And I could only use the words of a great man such as Dr. King. Just like he said, if you can't run, you walk. If you can't walk, you crawl. But whatever you do, keep moving forward. Thank you very much.
Distinguished alum, thank you very much. I tell all of our students and alums that you can go anywhere from BCC and look at the start that he had here and the great achievements that he's been able to accomplish. Now it's my privilege to introduce the Music One again. We're going to have Music One come back for more singing.
Again. All right, so this song I wrote is called I Bow Down to You. I'm gonna let this song speak for itself. I hope you guys like it.
Sitting in an empty hall without the words to say, and I know nothing at all without you. I need you to give me the words to say. day. You're the moon that gives me the light to see when it's dark, and the stars, they bow down to you. You're the one that holds on my faith. You're the one that will never fade from me and my heart. You're the one I bow down to you. I'm here and I'll give you my all, and still there won't be no to thank you for what you have done. Up my day, you're the moon that gives me the light to see when it's dark, and the stars, they bow down to you. You're the sun that lights up my day, you're the moon that gives me the light to see when it's dark, and the stars, they bow down to you. They bow down to you. I bow down to you.
Music One, keeping with the tradition and inspiration of Dr. King. Now it's my privilege to introduce our keynote event. Brothers Keeper is a poetry and spoken word ensemble that seeks to bring healing, inspiration, and encouragement, exploring many topics from a male perspective. They will make you think and make you feel. Please welcome Brothers Keeper. Brothers Keeper.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see.
I'm happy today to join you in what will go down as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. 70 years ago, a great American whose image is etched into a copper coin signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to a great many millions of Negro slaves who had been searing in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 150 years later, the Negro still is not free. 150 years later, the life of a young black man or woman is still treated as a thing with no value. 150 years later, we still find ourselves wrestling with the same concerns as we try to come to terms with how we could have a time when we have a president of mixed race, and yet the country seems to be more divided than ever. And so we've come here today to our nation's capital to dramatize a shameful condition. In a sense, we've come to our nation's capital to cash a check. When the architects of the Republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, they were signing a promissory note to which every American was to fall heir. This note was a promise that all men, yes, black men and white men, will be guaranteed the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It is obvious that America has defaulted on this promissory note insofar as her citizens of color are concerned. Instead of honoring this sacred obligation, America has given the Negro people a bad check, a check which has come back marked insufficient funds. But we refuse to believe that the Bank of Justice is bankrupt. We refuse to believe that there are insufficient funds in the great vaults of opportunity in this nation. And so we've come to cash this check, a check that will give us upon demand the riches of freedom and the security of justice. Many of our young people are frustrated and angry at the current state of affairs, feeling very much that their lives still don't matter, and not much has changed, even as I gave that dream speech 50 years ago. Many of us find ourselves on opposite sides of the questions. Many want to deflect from the urgency of now, saying, why can't all lives matter equally? And we find ourselves saying, ironically, we were wondering quite the same thing. But hashtags and catchphrases can't define the struggle. Only when we adopt the position that we are our brother's keeper will we ever be able to reach that day when all lives, black lives, white lives, Mexican immigrant lives, sub-Saharan lives, all lives will matter. Because we are inevitably our brother's keeper. Because we are all our brother's brother. Whatever affects one directly affects the other indirectly.
He opened my eyes. Well, it's amazing. Now I can see your favor towards me, favor towards me. I'm thankful, so grateful. I praise your name forever. Your grace, it's amazing to me.
Martin Luther King said, put yourself in a state of mind where you say to yourself, there is an opportunity for me to celebrate like never before. My own power, my own ability to get myself to do whatever is necessary. There you go.
Celebrate yourself. Assume positive results. Every atom that we have belongs to all of you. This is an invitation to our souls. Smell and taste green summer. Crowd shells with perfume that help you fall in love with the fragrance of yourself. Remember the atmosphere's aftertaste. It is not black. unplanned or odorless. We are in love with our mouth, lips, teeth, tongue, and the sounds that it manipulates. Your heartbeat is your inspiration for giving never-ending kisses and light embrace. I'm delighted that my seed seeks similar fields and hillsides. Remember that bad health is not death. So sing to the sun. Let your dreams run 1,000 acres. Be proud of your accomplishments. Dissect poems, not animals. Burn cant from speech. There are millions of suns left for your soul's revival. All we are is complex plants covered by hardened clay. You see my beard? That's my connection to the universe. Our branches grow without limits. You can too. Go ask an ant how to overcome. Children play peacefully in grass. Blind adults like me cut grass, burn leaves, kill weeds, and then replace it all with plastic scenes. Even poets can't decipher these graffiti and hieroglyphics. But we love writing riddles. So let's keep this poem simple. Do good, give respect, and I promise you, you will receive minds. And tonight, when you go home, I want you to call your mother and tell her I love you. Go back to being toddlers on parents' laps. Eventually, parents grow old and die. That's why. Kiss your children while you can. They go onward and outward until you collapse. Watch what you eat. Make sure that it gives you the sustenance and strength that you need. And then ask yourself, what are you? Who are you? And where are you going? And if you don't know, then let the conversation of 10,000 words begin. Erase could have, erase should have, and just live.
The only weapon we have in our hands this evening is the weapon of protest. That's all. Pull it back and squeeze. Lost boys search for manhood, exploring the golden paved streets of a brick city spattered in violence. Silence overcomes a shooter's whole body split seconds before
"Ayo!"
is yelled.
Pull it back and squeeze. It's automatic, empty. Reload and shoot some more until fingers are sore and bleeding. Victims pleading for mercy, but bloodthirsty, smooth criminals place no value in human life.
Deafening shots echo through the war-torn blocks of our village. Decades of spillage taught these lost boys to have heart.
Thirsty for cream.
You know what I mean.
The American dream got you on your hands and knees. They teach capitalism in the schools.
But they ban the Bible.
They tell you all about the business cycles and you become disciples.
They're lying to you. Courage is bought off-road in dark alleyways. Sons of guns jammed to arrhythmias. Sinister melodies are Teflon-coated,
locked and loaded. Pull it back and squeeze. Eager students and devout followers take the bait while the big fish swallow us. Go down, Moses. Tell Pharaoh to
let my people go. We put Christ on hold.
In the midnight of crisis for the cash flow, the Benjamins got a chokehold on my community's neck.
Adrenaline junkies murmur irregular mantras like,
keep it real.
I'ma do me.
Get money.
It's funny how time flies.
Years ago, we were moving targets.
Now with an urban market.
Targeted in different ways.
Soon as we get paid,
the man wants his check back.
Well, our kids get left back.
And the school systems backtrack.
Pull it back.
And squeeze.
Faster slugs hit kids cracking sternums.
Depositing life lessons right into
the right ventricle.
Releasing the anger
pent up inside the oppression pressure cooker.
Upstanding women become hookers selling flesh in the interest of
clocking those dollars.
Ducats and pesos, the police chase bros around the tenements.
But the truth is self-evident.
The inhabitants of this country
still go hungry.
For the proof isn't in the pudding.
It's in the pudding of your faith in these small green rectangles.
When the willow's over your eye,
you can't see from all the angles.
They wash your thinking cap.
Now your brain is star-spangled.
Jingle.
Jangle.
Music to your ears.
Or a precursor for tears.
If your worst fear is losing your last dollar,
you might as well pick up that slave collar.
And begin the cycle again.
Whether it's pounds or yen,
that money ain't your friend.
You're talking nonsense. Capitalism ain't got no conscience. Like the criminal
who pull it back and squeeze. Pop, pop.
Two shots invested into this lost boy's chest.
With no return or added value.
He prays to God as his pulse weakens.
Last breath taken, January 18th, MLK weekend.
Pull it back and squeeze.
Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. What if I said our lives matter instead of saying Black lives matter? Would that make you feel better, more comfortable? Would you feel included? When the Declaration of Independence was signed by 56 men, when poplar trees demanded the hanging of Black men, when Mamie Till declared an open casket, did our lives matter? There was a time that we were three-fifths important, biding our time for inclusion. Fought and died in every war, but claiming America's freedom. But when liberty rang, we became the back of the bus, wait your turn, second-class citizens. Did our lives matter when Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, knowing that in his mind, we have become an inferior state? What about Margaret Sanger, singing a song of extermination? It's funny when those who stake their claims with all lives matter indirectly white out the discrepancies of a judicial system that blatantly proves otherwise. Does Rodney King matter? Does Katrina matter? What about Central Park Five? And let me throw in Jenna 6. And how could we ever forget the Tuskegee experiment? If it accommodates you, all lives do matter. But are you willing to lay down white privilege that prevents you from looking back? There's a lump under the rug that we all are accounted for. Our lives matter too, but it neglects the splinter between the fingernail. It ignores our Black children from coming home at night. It pretends that disparity is nothing more than an old wives' tale. So yes, our lives matter too. We just color-coded so you can taste the flavor of our pain. No cream, no sugar, just a medium-sized cup of coffee of Black bitterness. Black lives matter, even as America continues to pretend that they do. Thank you.
Am I my brother's keeper? His arms no longer show the expressway to euphoria. Track marks reveal the traffic jam of scabs detouring him to Blue Bandit's calf. Instead, am I my brother's keeper?
He punches in at around 3 a.m. The corner becomes his office window. A Glock 9 becomes his insurance policy. But it doesn't mean it covers his health care. Am I my brother's keeper?
He's infatuated with guns and women,
fully loaded when he pulls his trigger, both life and death are conceived. Dead bodies buried in the Providence River. Newborn babe at women and infants. Both missing persons, not even cared for. Am I my brother's keeper?
Am I my brother's keeper? To keep my eyes closed and head down, ignoring his ignorance, displaying my distaste for his discrepancies, dissolving my scruples, degrading my decisions. Am I my brother's keeper?
We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but our false principles force us to look the other way.
We all read the gospel according to
mind your own business.
The manuscript that proclaims it has nothing to do with me.
The section of the Torah which contains verses about selective seeing.
The Torah which tells us to tread lightly towards other people's troubles.
Am I my brother's keeper? We educate ourselves for the betterment of self. We learn not to lean in on the lives of others. We grasp onto the mistakes we make and avoid any conflict or confrontation.
As crazy as it sounds, when strangers make noise, we draw the shades over our ears, blocking their sounds with our mouths muted, witnessing domestic drama with our eyes closed.
Oh, we'll shout from the mountaintop over racial inequalities. We'll make noise when gas prices soar. We'll even call out those that abuse their political positions.
But when Leroy is beating his wife, and our next door neighbor's being robbed by Debo, when Keisha's all cracked out and 7 months pregnant
from her uncle, from that time she went down south.
We're so quiet.
We get tunnel vision. We'll even cringe.
When we hear about what happened at Penn State.
Chris Brown and Rihanna.
R. Kelly or O.J. Simpson.
Don't even go there.
We don't make eye contact with the less fortunate.
It draws unwanted responsibility. We shy away from other people's pain.
And make up the guilt with turkey and Christmas donations.
Shame holds us hostage to forced charity, to the chump change we contribute to these charitable organizations.
Will only give us a false sense of godliness.
Am I my brother's keeper?
Yes, I am.
Hunger visits the rich and the poor. Calamity keeps a blind eye to whomever walks in its path.
And we can't wait for another Katrina, or Rita, or Fukushima to find it in our hearts to give.
As if it wipes the slate clean and keeps the guilt off our turn backs.
Life tsunamis happen on a daily.
Causing the foreclosure of our souls to suicide's bittersweet serenade.
People pouring off their principles in exchange for putting proper provision on the table.
Starvation is a universal language of poverty.
But we are deaf to the travesty of hungry bellies.
The stench of neglect is still here.
The stain of apathy won't go away.
The ugliness of Wall Street is now highlighted in the occupation
of public spaces by those who previously had occupations.
While the military-industrial complex remains a complex occupation.
And the military seems to have a strange preoccupation with occupation.
So yes, I am my brother's keeper.
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 Offering spoken nourishment to a dying world.
Lighten a load from my brother's back.
Lending him a helping hand.
Helping him to stand on his own two feet.
Keeping my brother as I am.
Am I my brother's keeper?
Yes, I am.
Thank you.
Our brother's keeper, ladies and gentlemen. Wasn't that wonderful? As is our tradition, before we close, let's stand and join together in the great anthem of civil rights movement, We Shall Overcome, and then we will have our benediction. We start with the music. One picture, I guess. Okay. Thank you for helping us out. Do you get a key for us?
Yes.
Okay. All right, ladies and gentlemen, if we can join hands, and the words, if you don't know them, are on the back of the program. Okay, here we go. We shall overcome. We We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall overcome someday. We'll walk hand in hand. We'll walk hand in hand. We'll walk hand in hand someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome someday. We shall all be free. We shall all be free. We shall all be free someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome someday. Thank you very much. We have Rabbi Mark Elber from Temple Beth El to provide our benediction.
The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "We must all learn to live together as brothers and sisters, or we will all perish together as fools. We are tied together in the single garment of destiny, caught in an inescapable network of mutuality." These prophetic words are even more obviously true today as we increasingly acknowledge the interdependency of people and nations. We must cherish each individual as sacred and recognize that we all belong to the family of humanity. We are all part of the living organism that is our planet. We are custodians of this magnificent creation, and the health of our home depends on how we treat and respect each other and the planet itself. May compassion and justice always guide our moral compass. May we always see the divine spark in our fellow humans and in all of creation. May we grow ever closer to our ideals, and may freedom, justice, and equality for all no longer be a dream, but a reality. May we recognize each other as allies in this grand vision and continue to draw inspiration from the prophetic example of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. May we live to see a world in which peace and harmony are so pervasive that everyone can take them for granted. Let us say, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi. That concludes our presentation. I should point out that at Bristol Community College, we have a firm policy of zero tolerance for disrespect for others, and I hope you will inculcate that into your personal dealings, not just at Bristol Community College, but throughout the community. We've got to change the way things are moving, and are going in the wrong direction in many cases. That concludes our program. Thank you very much. Please don't forget the Bethel AME ceremony, 146 Hanover Street. Thank you very much for coming.